I belong. do we want to honor our very own Ron? I'm sorry, but he lays his life down every day for us. And he's not just a pastor. He's not happy unless we're activated. He is truly, his passion is to see each of us walk in our destiny. And he's not happy just teaching. If he can't see us do what he does, if he doesn't see us move forward in our giftings, then he's not happy. So we're going to take an offering, and you can, and if you're not prepared for an offering tonight, we'll take an offering tomorrow night as well. And or you can double dip. You can give twice. So you can make your check out to Epic as usual, or you can even make it out to Ron Griggs, like I did. And or cash. So with that, as we pass the baskets, I want to introduce a man that I just love and respect so much, our very own Ron Griggs.
Okay, I'm not coming on at all. Oh, there it is. Now I'm on. Wow. You know, Debbie, you're so amazing. Actually, I think it was last year when Debbie was interning for us, I was going to speak somewhere, and they wanted to have a bio. So Debbie said, well, I can help with the bio. Oh, you remember the bio you wrote? I read it and I thought, well, who's that? It was so amazing. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Man, it made me want to cry. Well, I mean, I'm going to grab a stool. Is that okay, guys?
Sure. That's okay.
Yeah.
Should we pray now?
So, yeah, maybe we should. I'm going to turn this off and put it over here somewhere. Because I'm wired. I'm connected tonight. Pre-service prayer was a lot of fun, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And so was worship.
Yeah.
So good. But, you know, when you speak to a group of people, you never know who you're going to get. And it's like, okay, it's like homecoming.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, Lord, I hope this message works. Because I thought maybe we would have a number of people that really needed to increase their faith with healing. And I guess we can always all increase our faith. And so I wanted to, that was one of the things I wanted to start with, is increasing faith for healing. So I know there's times, oh, my battery's going dead. Yeah, I should have put a fresh one in. Hang on just a sec, guys.
It's prophetic. Yeah.
You're getting recharged. I can't remember how to open this window in my eyes. I may have to get Daniel up here to help me open it. Let's see.
Oh, got a hammer.
Okay, two double A's, yeah. And dispose of those batteries properly, please.
Anybody who knows me knows
their problem. I hope Julie Anderson isn't watching.
She is watching.
No, I actually, we're in competition tonight, unfortunately. Not competition, we don't look at it as competition, but there's an event in Redmond, a prophetic thing, and Jeff Reynolds had put together, and he forgot what weekend we did Global Legacy. He actually apologized to me for that.
So
there's a few people over there at that event. And, of course, there's a guy by the name of Randy Clark that's speaking tonight. Tonight's last night, right, for the healing and impartation school. How many of you guys have ever been to that? Oh, wow. Okay, so not that many. Really? Well, this is going to be better than an inaugural ball tonight. I really believe that.
Yeah.
But, you know, I wanted to really release faith tonight. You know, there's so many times in scriptures where, you know, Jesus would say, your faith has healed you. But that wasn't always the case. Mm-hmm. And every, you know, and sometimes what we do in this walk with the Lord, we see something and we go, ah, that's the formula. Well, you know, faith does play in a lot of times. But I've seen people healed that had absolutely no faith.
Yeah.
And claim they were atheists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right.
You know, so there's times that your faith does heal you, but there's other times you just get healed.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. You know, and the bummer is one of the things that we've done in the church, because we think that way, and faith is good, don't get me wrong, faith helps. But we've bundled it all together, and sometimes we think people don't get healed because they don't have faith.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so we start putting the blame on somebody, and mm-hmm. that's just wrong.
Yeah.
You know, we don't understand a lot of things that happen in the spirit realm, and we don't know sometimes why somebody doesn't get healed. Sometimes there's things that are just unknown to us, or I mean, I'm actually going to go into some of those things maybe later tonight. We'll see. I don't want to get too far down that road. But faith is a great thing, but it isn't the cure-all for everybody to get healed. I mean, there's other things that can play into their not getting healed besides you just don't have enough faith. And the reality is most of that is taken from a scripture where in Mark, and we'll look at it, where Jesus went back to his hometown. And everybody says, well, he couldn't do stuff because of their lack of faith. That really isn't what it says there. And we'll look at that a little bit later.
Cool.
But I want to talk about, I want to talk about our calling. You know, as Debbie said, my heart is that every one of you would be operating at a high level in healing and other gifts. You know, if you read in Ephesians where, is it Ephesians 4, where Paul's talking about Jesus gave some to the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. He goes on to say, for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And that is really our calling. And you know, I think most everybody in this room tonight probably knows this, but there's seasons in the church. There's reformations, if you will. And we've been going through it. And Bethel, I think, has been responsible for it. And Randy Clark's been responsible for a reformation of understanding, as Randy Clark would say, that the little old me's, you know, can see the miracles, can pray, you know, for the sick and they will get healed. I really struggle tremendously with that terminology, little old me's, because there's none of us are little old me's. There's nobody in this room that's a little old me. You know, there was a time maybe where the enemy told you you were a little old me, but the reality is you're powerful. And you're a child of God. And you were created to be powerful, and the kingdom of heaven is within you. And one of the things that I love to do when we go places is find somebody in the room that would be the least likely for God to use. A number of years ago, we were in Juarez, and I actually had it wasn't really a word of knowledge. I just asked a simple question. Is there anybody... Oh, by the way, as I'm talking tonight, if the Holy Spirit begins to fall on you and you know you need healing, I want you to just stand up, because we'll go after that. So I asked this question. I said, is there anybody in the room that has duct tape for my ear? Oh, that's what I said. I said, is there anybody in the room that you've had something for 15, 20, 25, 30 years? And you were there, Dave, and Pastor Antonio's wife, who was in the back, raised her hand. I said, would you come here? And she came up with a walker and came up front. And I, you know, I asked, what have you had for 30 years? What's been going on? And she said, well, I've had a hip pain and hip problems for 30 years. And there happened to be a little girl that was probably like 10 years old, I would guess, on the front row. And I called her up there, up, and I said, you know, do you know Jesus? And she said, yes. And I said, well, you know, Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is within you. Mm-hmm. And what I would like you to do is put your hand on this woman's hip and simply say, I release the kingdom of heaven. Mm-hmm. 30 years. And the woman was healed immediately.
Wow.
You see, there's no junior Holy Spirit. The same Holy Spirit that resides within me resides in everybody who knows Jesus.
That's right.
You know, he's not a junior in somebody small. You know, the last time we went down to Guadalajara, this was kind of a funny thing, because, you know, what I wanted to do is I wanted to prove a point to people that anybody can lay hands on the sick and see them healed. And I had a word of knowledge for knees, and I released it, and there was two girls that came forward. Girls, I would say both of them were probably around 30-ish. You know, they all look alike to me, but, you know, somewhere around 30-ish. And one of them had one knee that was bad, and the other one had both knees. They had issues. And I said, is there anybody here in the room that you have never in your life laid hands on somebody and seen them healed? And there was a number of hands that went up, and there was this guy in the back that I said, you, come on up here. And as he's coming up, you know how a lot of times when you look at somebody who knows Jesus, you can tell? You know, they kind of got that glow and the smile. He had none of that. Oh my goodness. Anyway, I just told him, I said, you're going to pray for them. And so they're standing on the stage, and he gets down kind of on one knee, and he actually extended his hand across both knees on one gal and then got the other knee like that. And I don't know what I had him pray, something like, be healed in Jesus' name. I mean, it was not this exotic, crazy, amazing, long prayer. I know one thing it wasn't. It wasn't a prayer that was, if you want to heal him, Jesus, do it.
That's right.
Because I don't pray that way. But it was commanding healing. And I can't remember, did either one of them get healed the first time you prayed?
I don't think so.
I don't think either one of them did. And I said, pray again.
Yeah.
And then when he prayed the second time, I think one of them got healed, and I said, pray a third time. And as he's praying the third time, he falls over. And the look on his face was worth $1 million. Because he was the most astonished person in the room. He's thinking, what just happened to me? I mean, this is a guy that I'm not sure even knows Jesus.
Yeah.
He never prayed for anybody for healing, and he falls over and can't get up. He's laying there like, what has... Both gals get healed. But they actually... Some guys had to actually help him go back to his seat. They had to come up and take him off the stage. But what happens in that instance is everybody in the room has a faith increase.
Yeah.
You know, they all of a sudden go, that dude had no idea.
Yeah.
I was not touching him. He was just there praying and fell over. So my heart is to have people believe that they can lay hands on the sick. We went to Playa del Carmen, I think it was a little over a year ago. We did some meetings in a church there, and I actually invited a kid up to minister there. And I said, just hold your hands up, and I want you to declare this. In fact, you guys can do this. Just hold your hands up and declare this. These hands are powerful.
These hands are powerful.
These hands have healing in them.
These hands have healing in them.
When I lay hands on the sick, things change. Anyway, I had him say something like that. Then I had a word of knowledge for something. I mean, the first person that came up, he prayed for him, and shock on his face. They got healed instantly. You know, and I would have him lift his hands again. These hands are powerful. So as we start tonight, I just pray that your faith is increased. You know, if you need healing in your body, I pray that as we talk about faith and your faith level goes up, that the Holy Spirit, like a magnet, would be attracted to your body. And healing would come.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you, Lord. So let me pray. Father, you're so good. And Lord, I know that you are our healer. You have a heart to heal, and obviously you have the power to heal. You live within us, and I just pray, Father, that there would be some surprise healings tonight.
Yes.
I pray that you would guide me by your Holy Spirit. Whatever you want to do tonight, that's what we want to do.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Amen. So as I was preparing, this is actually scripture that they jumped out at me. It's Acts 26:8. And this is Paul speaking. And he's speaking in front of Agrippa and King Agrippa. And he says, this is such an interesting. And there was Pharisees there, and just, you know, all the officials. And he says, why should any of you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? When I read that the other day, I thought, that is so amazing. Why would any of you feel that it's incredible that God raises the dead? Think about that for a second. Why would that be an incredible thing to us that God raises the dead? Yeah, but do we believe that he formed Adam and fashioned Eve? Do we believe that he spoke everything into existence? So why would it be difficult for him to raise the dead?
Sure.
It's not. It's not at all. And I thought, Paul, I just love you. He just says it matter-of-factly.
Mm-hmm.
Why would any of you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? You know, you know that God's here. We, for those who came when we were supposed to start, some of us came an hour early, and we just got in the presence of God. We felt God. We tangibly felt his presence in here. Why would you consider it incredible that God raises the dead? How hard is it for God to raise the dead? How hard is it for him, if he can raise the dead, to heal our mortal bodies?
Yeah.
I want to just, like you say, when I prepared, I thought there might be some here tonight that maybe weren't sure what our call was as believers. And so we're just going to kind of go through that process. I want to show you some things in the Word. Because the more you're convinced in your heart that this is our calling, the more you're going to step out into it.
Mm-hmm.
The more you're convinced that this is what the Lord has called us to, the more you're going to receive healing yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to start with Matthew 28, starting in verse 16. This is what we call the Great Commission. You know what that means, Great Commission? Well, great is great. It's like epic. This is the epic commission, right? But what's a commission? It's ascending forth. This is what you were created for, basically. This is what he's telling his disciples. He's got 11 disciples in front of him, and he's telling them, this is what you were created for. This is what your job on earth is. And, you know, we've all heard this. But sometimes, you know, you can read a scripture and you might miss something that's contained within the scripture. It says, then the 11 disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And, you know, let me just stop right there. You know, for those who don't think that Jesus is God, they worshipped him. You're only supposed to worship God. And he didn't tell them to stop. You know what I'm saying? There's a good point right there.
Right there. That's a good
yeah.
point right there.
God's the only one to be worshipped. Mm-hmm. They worship him. He didn't say stop it. Okay. That was actually a freebie. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now listen to this next line. Because really this next line is showing them what the disciples are. He's telling them to go make disciples and baptizing them. And then he says, this is what it looks like. And teaching them to obey. Now, that word obey means obedience is action. To do something, right? Mm-hmm. Are we in agreement there?
Yes. Yeah.
Obey is to do. Mm-hmm. Everything. Can you guys say everything?
Everything.
I have commanded you.
And
surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. You know, we've made, in some instances, we've made discipleship this thing where we just learn scripture or memorize it. And all that's good. You know, you need to meditate on the word. You need to study your Bible. But true discipleship actually has wheels to it. It actually has action. It's not just learning scripture. And, you know, a lot of times in the church, that's what we've turned it into. Even though the Apostle Paul says to the Corinthians, he says, the kingdom of God is not a matter of word, but of power. He says to the Corinthians, he says, I didn't come to you with persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the power of the Spirit, so that your faith does not rest on men's wisdom, but on the power of God.
Yeah.
This whole thing that we're involved with is about the power of God. It's about obedience, and it's doing what Jesus commanded his disciples to do.
Yeah.
See, they were commanded, go make disciples and teach them to obey all,
yeah.
everything that I commanded you. So what did he command them to do? Well, you know, we can easily stop with, well, you know, to love your neighbor as yourself. And, you know, that's good. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, that's good. You know, there are some things that I think the church has, as a whole, has grasped onto that are really good, but they're not the whole. All those things are important. Loving is important. You know, feeding widows is important. Taking care of orphans, it's important. You know, loving one another is important. Studying the Bible is important. But he didn't say just a few of the things. He said everything. Everything I commanded you. So let's go to Matthew 10:5 to start with. Please. Or you can trust me. It's up to you. It's going to be recorded, so you can always go back later and see if I was telling the truth. 10:5-8. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not go among the Gentiles or enter any town of the Samaritans. Go rather to the lost sheep of Israel. As you go, preach this message. The kingdom of heaven is near. Heal the sick. You know, he didn't say pray for the sick. He said heal the sick. Raise the dead. What? Serious. That's a command? Cleanse those with leprosy, who have leprosy. And you know, that in that translation can be skin disease, actually, they say. Has anybody prayed for a leper in here? You have.
Did skin disease.
Yeah, oh, skin disease.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Healed.
And you're healed.
Yes.
So good. Drive out demons. I'm sure there's a few that have done that. Freely you receive, freely give. So here's a command. Those are all commands that Jesus commanded his disciples. You know, for those who would say that healing is gone, you know, that those, some of those gifts have passed away, we can't even fulfill the Great Commission without healing.
Yeah.
We can't do it without the power to heal, because that's part of the Great Commission.
That's good.
Let's see if he said, what else he might have said. Luke 10. Luke 10:9. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God is near you. Okay, there it is again. Listen, there was actually a study done in Latin America. It was done by the Randy Clark organization. Well, actually, let me back up. Randy told about it. It was actually done by a university that wanted to study divine healing. And they actually had somebody that was like their, what do you call it, a thesis or whatever.
Doctorate.
A what?
Their doctorate.
Yeah. Anyway, so their doctorate. So they went out and they actually did a study on divine healing. And you know what they found? That in, and it's almost identical in Africa and Latin America, that 85% of the people that come to Jesus, and they're the first person in their family that comes to Jesus, came to Jesus through a miracle. Mm-hmm. Either they got healed, a friend, or a family member. Well, I guess it wouldn't be a family member. Friend, or they got healed. 85%. I can't tell you how many people, when we were in Mexico, somebody would bring someone for prayer, they would get healed, and they would receive Jesus. Then they would go tell somebody else, they would come, they would get healed, and they would receive Jesus. It's really a great way to do outreach.
Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
Yep.
Kill two birds with one stone.
Exactly.
Bring two deaths to life.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know, one of the things that I think we have to break off is this idea that to get somebody saved, we need to take them to church. You know, it's really old school thinking. Yeah. It's this idea that all ministry takes place within the local church. Mm-hmm. You know, and that really that isn't the way that Jesus did it. What did he do? He didn't tell his disciples, let's all gather around in a soccer stadium mm-hmm. and see if we can get some people to come to us.
Right.
I mean, and there's nothing yeah. wrong with that. I've had that prophesied over me and I plan on doing it. But I really believe what the world's waiting for is a bunch of powerful Christians
yeah.
that will decide when I go to work and I see somebody who I'm friends with and they're dealing with something in their physical body, that I will actually love them enough to decide I'm going to pray for them. And I'm not going to let fear be my controller. You know, God's not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and sound mind. And the reality is we're bowing down to a false god when we let fear control us.
That's good.
Thanks.
We're bowing down to a false god when we allow fear to control us rather than the Holy Spirit. Because fear is a spirit. So there's a spirit that we're bowing down to when we let fear be the control of our life. And it's a good word. And listen, I'm not saying that to condemn anybody. I'm just telling you that's the truth. And I've been there and I bowed down to that stinking demon. But I'm choosing not to any longer. God, you know what? I'm telling you, there's a higher percentage of people to get healed in the streets than in the church.
Yeah.
You know, I've been to clinics in Bend. I've been other places where I was getting a physical a couple years ago. A kid comes in, black kid, which was kind of unusual in Bend. You know, we don't see that many. It was kind of fun. But he had his hand all wrapped up and in a lot of pain, and he looked like a gang member, really. And then all tattered up and everything. And I thought, well, here's a perfect opportunity. I said, what happened to your hand? I don't even remember I think he hit something. I don't think it was anybody's face, but I can't remember for sure. But I think he had hit something, and he had fractured all the bones. And he was coming in to get a cast put on. Because he was in just a terrible amount of pain, and he needed to be healed. And I just said, well, can I pray for you? Now, this is a rough, tough gang member. He said, okay. You know, he didn't pull a knife on me. He threatened me. You better not try to do something nice to me. He didn't do anything like that. He said, okay. I prayed for him for 10 seconds. He's like, huh, there's no pain in my hand any longer. It's completely gone. Do you think maybe that it was worth it for me to take a risk?
Wow.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm sure it probably changed his life.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. I would guess. If some weird, strange guy did that for me, I really should reconsider my options in life. You know what I'm saying? You know, the other one is Luke 10:9. We'll read it just because the Word of God is. Or did I read Luke 10?
Yeah, yes, you did.
I missed one. Did I read Matthew 10?
No.
Oh, that's the one I missed.
Matthew 10:5-8, you read.
Yeah.
Oh, well, there's one more here somewhere, but I missed it. Okay. Oh. Yeah, Luke 9. Let's go to Luke 9. You know, I just put a lot of scriptures on here, and I'm just trying to go through them. This one is kind of interesting. Luke 9:1. It says, when Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. And he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. So that's so interesting. He's got power, authority, drive out demons, cure diseases, and heal the sick. So obviously, in this context, heal the diseases and cure the sick. Cure the diseases and heal the sick are two different things. You know, one of the things that I learned a lot in Mexico, well, let's back up, authority. A lot of illness is actually caused by spiritual forces. And you need authority to get rid of spiritual forces. And so, one of the things that helped me when I learned how to pray, things changed for me. You know, I used to be like a lot of people. Well, first of all, I used to, oh Lord, if it's your will, maybe possibly to heal this person, but if you want, you know, how many of you know, I didn't see too many people healed. And then I started kind of operating a little bit more in less doubt, and Father, would you come and heal this person? And, you know, I started to see a few people healed. But I had this revelation that nowhere in Scripture did Jesus ask the Father to come heal somebody. He didn't tell his disciples to go out and ask the Father to heal anyone. He said, heal the sick. And what did he do? He simply healed the sick. He said, you know, like Peter's mother-in-law, you know, he told the fever to go. What's the wording? He didn't renounce it. He rebuked it. He rebuked the fever. So what does that tell you when somebody rebukes something? I would say it's a spirit. It's of the enemy. He rebuked a spirit that was causing her to have a fever. And the spirit had to go. You know, when I began to tell illness to come off of people, it's like I had this guy one night that came to church on a Wednesday night, and Patty and Cesar had brought him, and he received Jesus. And at the end of the service, he said, Pastor, would you pray for me? I've been sick. I said, sure. So I got some oil out, you know, the whole James thing. And when I got ready to pray for him, and this is a key, is listen to Holy Spirit. I got ready to pray for him, and I felt like I was supposed to tell a spirit of infirmity to release him. So I anointed him with oil, and I said, spirit of infirmity, come out of him now in Jesus' name. He hit the floor. And he, and I'm like, well, dude, he is sick. And I was. You know, I thought maybe he had, I don't know, a little sniffles or something, you know. But I kind of figured out real quick there was really something attacking him. You know, and I won't go into that part of the story, but like 6 months later, he started coming to our church, and, you know, and, hey, what can I do to help? And, you know, we were actually building this little office in the house we were renting. We actually were turning the little garage into an office thing, and he was helping me with that. And he said, oh, Pastor, by the way, you know, I didn't tell you what I was sick from when you prayed for me. I'm like, oh, no, you didn't. He said, well, I have leukemia. He said, I was living in Canada, and I got sick, and the doctors told me there was nothing they could do, and they sent me home to Mexico to tell my family goodbye. They said that, and they'd given me 6 months to live. I'm like, oh, okay. I'm really glad that he didn't tell me that.
Right, yeah.
Because I didn't want to know all the details. You know, if somebody comes to you and they tell you, I'm sick, would you pray for me? And Benny Hinn's prayed for me, and Bill Johnson's prayed for me, Randy Clark's prayed for me, and nothing's, you know, no, that's okay, I'll get it sometime. I might start losing my faith a little bit when I pray for people. I don't want to know all those things.
Right. Yeah.
I don't even want to know all the details of what's going on. I just want a simple idea of what's happening. Because I want my faith to stay at a high level.
Yeah.
How many of you know it's easier to pray for a headache than leukemia?
Oh, yeah.
You know? But it's just as easy for God to heal either one.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
You know, and so I was like, cool. And he's still alive. That's been 7, 8, 9 years ago. I don't know. He's on Facebook. Yeah, he's still alive.
He's married, got babies.
No, that's right. He got married and babies and everything. I don't know where I was going with all that. But, you know, it's about listening to the Holy Spirit when you pray. You know, because he'll give you, a lot of times he'll give you hints. When I was down in Brazil, and I was just out walking through the crowd, just, you know, looking for somebody to
whack.
We did, yeah, I had a little fun whacking people. But this time I was actually looking for somebody to pray with. And, you know, what I experienced a lot of times in Latin America is people would be really shy and not necessarily come forward or whatever. I would go somewhere and minister and I would call out a word of knowledge and nobody would respond. What do you think that did to my faith? I'm like, gosh, I didn't get that right. You know, and I'd go ahead and pray with people and people would get healed and stuff. Then at the end of the service, somebody who had been there the whole service would come up to me and explain exactly what I called out. But they didn't come forward because they were too shy or whatever. You know, and so anyway, what I learned is, you know, sometimes you need to go to them. And so I was walking out and there was a guy, nicely dressed guy, and I went over to him and I just asked, do you need prayer for something? Well, he was deaf in his right ear. He was a pastor. Him and his wife were sitting there. And the first thought that came to me was there were things that were said to him that actually defiled his ear.
Oh.
I was like, okay. So I applied the blood of Jesus. I just said, I just wash away the blood of Jesus. I cleaned his ear out with the blood of Jesus. You know, I laid hands on him. And whatever defiled this ear, I wash away all defilement. I cleanse it in Jesus' name. And I command hearing restored. 100% healed. You know, and it was just listening to Holy Spirit. You know, allowing him to tell me what needed to happen.
Wow.
Yeah. But, you know, there's a lot of things that we pray for that there's actually roots to. You know, it's... How many of you know that God didn't create us to be sick? In fact, Jesus paid the price so that we wouldn't be sick. And so when I go to pray for somebody, I always try to listen. Is there something there that we need to address? Especially, you know, if you pray for somebody here's my thing. I expect somebody to get touched by the Holy Spirit when I pray for them. I expect healing because I understand that's who I'm called to be. I'm called to heal the sick. I'm not just called to go out and pray for the sick and it was just a good lesson for me. I expect healing. And so if I expect healing and I pray once or twice and nothing happens, well, first of all, Jesus never denied anybody healing in the scriptures. Everybody who came to him got healed. Even the Phoenician woman who had the daughter that was demonized, you know, there was a little bit of this and that going on. Then Jesus, finally she said, even the crumbs fall off the table and the dogs get the crumbs. And he said, go, your daughter's been set free or healed. I can't remember the verbiage there. And so Jesus never denied anybody healing in the scripture. Whenever I pray for somebody, I start from that point. I start from the point that says Jesus doesn't deny people healing.
Yeah.
And so if they don't get healed the first time and they don't get healed the second time, I pray a third and I pray a fourth and I pray a fifth time. Because I really believe what Jesus said was that the persistent widow was a picture of faith. You know, he talks about the widow that keeps coming before an unjust judge. And finally, even the unjust judge gives the widow what she wants. And he said it's the same with our Father in heaven. You know, that there's something, sometimes there is a persistence that is required for us to go after it. It's a test of our faith. Do we really believe for healing or not? If we pray, I heard somebody say one time, well, I just prayed for one people, and if they don't get healed, well, you know, I have enough faith they should get healed the first time. If they don't, then I don't pray again. And I'm like, what kind of is that? I didn't say it, did I?
Well, what about
ministry?
The time Yeshua prayed for a guy to regain his sight and the first time around, I see men
yeah.
like trees.
Even Jesus.
He prayed more than one time. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I always start from that perspective to believe that God's a healer. And, you know, if nothing happens, a lot of times I will ask questions that are maybe coming to my heart. if I'm not hearing another way to pray. I mean, we actually had a gal come down from Canada, her and her husband. I don't remember the whole story. Somehow they connected with us online. We went to a village to minister. She had never prayed for somebody to be healed in her life. They got healed. And I said, well, great, you can be part of our ministry team. I know that Jesus lives in her. I know that the Holy Spirit is within her. It doesn't matter how much practice she's had. It's not her healing anybody anyway. You know what? I can't heal anybody. It's God through me that heals people. You know, so I remember we had this old lady who was, I don't remember if she's all the way blind or like legally blind, could barely see at all. And this girl actually hears the Holy Spirit say, take some dirt from the ground and rub it over her eyes. I don't think she had to spit on her.
Yeah.
But she did take dirt from the ground and she rubbed it over her eyes and the lady was healed instantly. Now, let me tell you about what happened to her church in Canada. There was a major change.
Yeah.
Because she came back on fire. She started praying. I think she prayed for somebody who had cancer or something right after that. And they got healed and people started getting healed. We haven't had connection with them in a long time, but I'm telling you, lives are changed. When people are activated, things change. You know, we were in a village one time, and this was another one of those things, you know, the Mayan people are very shy, you know, very withdrawn. They don't have a lot of confidence, and, you know, I don't know what all that's about, but we were ministering in a village, and we had a guy, even before we started, his hernia was healed, and, I don't know, had a bunch of people in our service was healed, and afterwards, Christina came to me, she said, Dad, there's a deaf girl here. And she's too shy to come for prayer. I said, well, let's go find her. And this girl was probably about 12 years old. She was born deaf. And, you know, like I say, I prayed for her once. And, you know, I was doing this. And she's like, you know, because I kind of was giving her a signal, you know. And she's like, you know, I prayed for her a second time, and third time, and nothing's happening. And all of a sudden, I hear the Holy Spirit say, blow in their ears. I'm like, oh. you know, so I thought, hey, you know, you guys, this is going to look weird, but I really felt like the Holy Spirit just told me I'm supposed to blow in their ears. And so I blew in her right ear, blew in her left ear, and I snapped my fingers, and she said, whoa. And I said, really? You know, I'm going like this, and she goes, so I prayed again, tried again, no increase. Prayed again, tried again, no increase. Did that like three times. And Christina, I love Christina. She looks at me and says, Dad, blow in her ears again. Well, you know, it just felt so awkward. I didn't, just kind of felt weird. But every time I would blow in her ears, they would open up more and more and more and more.
Wow.
Until she could hear perfectly.
Wow.
Yeah, praise Jesus. You know, it's us taking a risk and us, you know, being willing to look dumb or whatever. You know, I'm going to be honest. Some of the hardest people I've ever prayed for that I felt the most resistance have been Christians in the American church.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, you know, where I almost felt like I might as well just walk away.
Yeah.
You know. Mm-hmm. You know, when Jesus went to his hometown, it wasn't a matter that those people were like, oh, we just don't have much faith. Help us with our faith. That wasn't what was happening there. They said, isn't this the carpenter's son? Yeah. Doesn't his mother live here and his brothers and sisters? And they were actually, like, mocking him. Mm-hmm. And it does say in the very end, Jesus was... at first, we're going to read that tomorrow, but it says Jesus could do very, I think it says Jesus could not do any miracles. Only a few people could he lay hands on and have them healed. And he was astonished at their lack of faith. You see, I don't think it was just somebody's lack of faith. It was, they were actually mocking him. They're saying, look, who is this? You know, they were making fun of him. It was more than they just didn't. You know, we can't take that scripture and put that on somebody who's believing for healing and say it's because of your lack of faith. It's a whole different picture. It's a whole different scenario. I mean, they were making fun of him. One of the things that I really believe, you know, because I've often asked the question, and there may be lots of reasons for why, Lord, do we see so many more miracles in Latin America than we do in America? You know, I've asked those questions because I love going to Latin America. Because I love what I get to see in Latin America. I love what I get to be a part of in Latin America. And one of the reasons that I really believe that the church in America has been a lot like those people in Jesus' hometown. They didn't necessarily mock. You know what Jesus Christ means? Well, you know, Jesus obviously is his first name. Christ is the anointed one. See, they haven't mocked Jesus, but they've mocked Christ. They've mocked the anointed. They've said, these things don't happen anymore. God doesn't do that kind of thing anymore. And we're talking about spiritual leaders in places of authority where they've been placed by God. Now, we know in the Word the power of words. Yes. It's throughout words. Life and death is in the power of tongues. Blessing and curses. Blessing and curses. You know what that means? That's not a cuss word. Curse doesn't mean a cuss word. Curse is releasing authority into the realm of the spirit that actually activates demons to go do something. That's a curse. So you think about within the American church, not all, but for a long time, most of the spiritual leaders actually released curses and saying, these things don't happen anymore. Saying, you can't lay hands on the sick and have them healed anymore. What are they doing? They're cursing those that are under authority, under their authority. So you come and you want to pray for somebody who's under that kind of covering, and you go, why? Why, Lord, is this battle going on? Why is there so much resistance? I really think that that's part of it. You know, the Catholic Church has never denied healing.
That's right.
So, you know what? When you go and pray for people in Latin America, they're not surprised that they get healed. Because they've never been told that it's gone. They've never been told that that passed away with the apostles. So, you know, you've got church leaders, and, you know, there's plenty of things that, you know, maybe I don't line up with the Catholic Church. But you have spiritual leaders in Latin America that are not denying the power of God.
That's right.
And so you've got people in Latin America that believe that the power of God is still available today. So you begin to pray for them and they expect healing. You know, there's not that spiritual thing going around over them where the covering has said no. You know, I don't understand all the dynamics of when you make an agreement with something in the spirit realm, but there are dynamics there. You know, Saul walks into the company of prophets who are prophesying. What happens? He prophesies. You walk into an atmosphere and you submit to a covering that doesn't believe in the supernatural. What's probably going to happen? There's going to be a stifling of what you carry.
That's right.
If you've submitted to that. There was a point where the Lord had told us in Mexico not to make a covenant agreement with a certain covering, because he said to me, it will limit what I can use you for. I said, what? So I didn't do it, and, you know, got called a lot of names. But that's a different story. You know, bless them. I shouldn't have said that. They're good people. They just didn't understand. why I had to say no.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and what I want to do is, I want to do some intercession for Central Oregon.
Yay.
Can we do that?
Yes.
Because Isaiah 61 says that the Lord has anointed us to preach good news, to bind up the brokenhearted, to set the captives free, to bring sight to the blind. It also says that you will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of His. It says you will rebuild the ancient ruins. You know what that is? That's rebuilding what God had in mind. It's rebuilding what the Lord had in store for a region. That's what we're called to. We're called to redeem this region for the Lord. So, Father, we forgive all the spiritual leaders who spoke against the Christ, the Anointed. We forgive them, Father. We forgive everyone, including, we ask for forgiveness for ourselves, for any careless words that we've ever spoke, that would limit your power, that would limit your authority, that would limit your church. Forgive us, Father. And Father, right now, we do use the authority that you've given us, and we break the power of all the words that were spoken over this region that would deny the anointing. We cancel the assignments of all demonic spirits associated with those words. And Father, Holy Spirit, we ask you to come. We ask you to come and rebuild the ancient ruins, everything that you have in mind for this region, Father. We ask that those things, we pull on heaven tonight.
Yes.
We pull on heaven tonight, and we come up to your courts, Father, and we ask for the plans. We ask for the plans that you had in mind for this region. Father, can we have them? Thank you, Father. We bring the plans from heaven to earth tonight. And we just say, be released upon the earth. Lord, we ask that every plan that you've had for Central Oregon would be realized in this season. Father, that the anointing once again would flow freely in this place. Not just this house, but every spiritual, every church building, every group of believers, every part of the body of Christ, that there would be an upgrade tonight, released upon the land. We declare new hope for those who feel hopeless. We declare goodness, your goodness, to be released. Father, I pray for everybody in this room for an upgrade tonight.
Yes, 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 yes.
Father, upgrade in faith, upgrade in mantle and anointing. Upgrade in words of knowledge. Father, I just pray tonight that every one of us will be changed in your presence. Your presence is here, Father. You can raise the dead. You can heal the sick. I just pray them right now, Father. I just declare your goodness over everybody in here who needs healing tonight. I release the goodness of God over your bodies. I release his kindness. I declare healing tonight. Set your church free, Father. Set your church free from mindsets. Father, we plead the blood of Jesus over the mind of every believer in Central Oregon, that their minds would be washed with the blood and all defilement that came to their minds in the way of misunderstandings and lies and just ignorance. Father, that those lies would be washed away tonight. That your people would be set free to believe that you are a powerful God. That you can raise the dead. You can heal the sick. You can cleanse the lepers, Lord. You can set people free. I pray for a revelation and a mindset change for every person who knows Jesus as Lord and Savior in Central Oregon. Even tonight, Lord, that you would set them free. Set us free. Father, that we can believe for the impossible. Because nothing's impossible with you. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. All things. In Jesus' name. Amen. Did anybody... Valerie, do you have any words of knowledge you feel like the Lord's given you for tonight? I actually had a pain in my left knee earlier, if anybody has that one.
Okay. I have left hand, stiff fingers, especially the little one. I don't know if it was an injury or arthritis.
Right there?
See his finger? It's flat. It's got a crink.
Okay, why don't you, we'll stand up and we'll call out some more. Just go ahead and stand up and we'll pray for you in a minute.
Okay, now I got right shoulder is kind of lower than the left, and like, you know how you stand and you're straight across this way? Mm-hmm. Well, it's kind of back and lower. Mm-hmm. And I got the sense it was smaller behind the plane of the left one, and that maybe it was a little weaker or withered.
You described my son's left shoulder. When he was little, he broke his collarbone, and so it didn't develop as big as the right. But it was his
Anybody with the left knee?
Yeah.
Oh, right there. Okay. Why don't you go ahead and stand up, Brian? Did we have any other words of knowledge?
I had top of the left foot, like its tendons were sore. Like when you go to move your toes, the tendons were sore.
So we do have, do we have anybody watching us?
My big toe doesn't bend because they did surgery, so it doesn't really hurt, it just doesn't bend on my left foot.
So, you got the left foot over there?
No. So, my boss's wife was showing me her finger. Did you say which finger did you say? The little finger?
Yeah.
And was
it
the left hand?
Yeah, left hand.
Okay, because, she showed me just at work the other day, and her finger had a nerve problem from shingles, and it was like,
oh, is her pain?
Like this, it was moving
doesn't want
by
straight.
Itself, like that. It's so cool.
So,
wow.
Yes.
Okay. Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So the Lord called that out. Yeah.
I don't know, but it feels like I might have broke something in my hand right in here. My fingers have all been just really hurting lately for the last couple of weeks, and I haven't really said anything. Just thinking they would go away, but it's actually been hurting more and more lately. Because,
okay.
On the left hand.
That's a real easy one. For God. I think that Linda actually has a special anointing for left hands. Just put your hand finger on it. Is it on the inside or outside? The pain.
The pain's, well, it's on both.
It's on both.
Back side and front side and this.
Has it changed yet?
Well, it's getting warm.
Yeah. Ooh, that's because Linda's got an amazing anointing to see left hands heal.
Woohoo!
How warm is it? What's the pain level at? Same or is it going down? Try something.
Well, I have to. Oh, it's a little better.
Okay. Well, sometimes Linda's anointing moves a little bit slow. But I think it'll increase. I'm kidding, Linda. Not about your anointing.
My faith is not discouraged.
No, but I think there's going to be an increase. The pain's going to go away. Cal, anything shift yet in that finger?
Any movement?
Can I hold hands with you?
Oh, yeah, please.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
So what's the pain level at now?
About halfway better.
Okay. I told you she has an amazing anointing for healing left hands completely.
Yeah.
I just declare this finger on Cal's left hand. Maybe she should have Linda pray for her. She's got an anointing. I just command this finger. I command this finger to the muscles to come back into proper formation. Is it a muscular thing?
No, it's a dislocation.
Oh, one of those.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Playing basketball?
Yeah, fell off the roof on the ladder. The ladder was my finger was underneath the ladder.
Like years ago?
About 5 years
ago. Yeah, so we just break off the trauma right now to this finger. And little finger, we just command you to be flexible again. We command the tendons and everything to loosen up right now. Loosen up, come back into proper formation in Jesus' name right now. All the way. Loosen up. Tendons, right now, I just stretch the tendons out and I command the tendons to be stretched right now. In alignment, right now. Right now, come into formation. Do not resist. I break all trauma off of this finger. In Jesus' name. Something going on?
Feeling like it's moving good.
Yeah, okay. More Holy Spirit. Did we have some other words of knowledge that... The left ankle. Somebody have a left ankle?
I have a left ankle.
I have a left ankle. You have pain in your left ankle? Oh, now Frank has got an anointing for left ankles. Particularly left ankles. Frank, would you go take care of that business?
Amen.
Stretch. I command your attention. Stretch, stretch, stretch. Do not lock up. Stretch, stretch. I release right now. I release flexibility to the tendons and the muscles and to the joints right now. Complete and total in Jesus' name. Let's do it. Do it. Complete. Complete. In Jesus' name.
So today I was reading the final reports on our trip. There were 71 blind eyes opened.
71.
Wow.
I restore flexibility in this finger. I restore flexibility right now in Jesus' name. Flexibility.
So that little finger is like.
Oh, this is easy.
Easy peasy. Easy peasy.
So, Kevin, what's going on back there?
Yeah.
I told you she's got an anointing.
Feels a lot better.
So, let's say when it first started, the pain was a 10. What is it now? Move freely.
Whenever I go at a certain angle, that's when I can really feel it. It's right in between here and here. It's like I hit something really hard, thinking about it, and boy, it just like it ripped something deep down, and it's been a couple of months now, you know.
Okay.
And so it's.
So just, Linda, just break the trauma off of that. And tell those bones to become solid. Just speak to them.
Kathy's friend. Kathy's friend that has a hand issue.
Can we call your friend?
Sure.
Let's call.
Oh, let's do it.
That would
be fun. Ron, you want to tell a testimony about Bill Johnson? Just told the testimony.
Oh, yeah. Bill Johnson was just telling, was it Randy Clark or somebody was there?
Yeah, it was Randy Clark was there.
In 2014. Yeah, I had a word of knowledge about somebody with an ankle issue with pins and steel plate. And I don't think, and I think the word was he didn't have any mobility. And so somebody was sitting there that knew a person that
was his aunt.
His aunt
in Eastern Canada, and she had broken her ankle so bad it was aiming.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, yeah. And they did all this metal pins and all that stuff. And she got up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom and realized she could walk.
So he had sent her a text, and she had turned her phone off.
Her phone was off.
So she didn't get the text. But she got up in the middle of the night to walk, and her leg was healed. Her ankle was healed. She got the text the next day.
After she and her husband went out to breakfast and she to celebrate, right? And she opened up her phone and saw the text.
And we, you know, we've seen people just as we were praying for somebody up front, just in the atmosphere, like they got splashed with the anointing or whatever it is, and just got healed. Never got prayer, realized, got home and realized, I'm healed.
Yes,
I can't tell you many times we've heard that testimony.
Yeah. That same 2014 at Randy's, they had prayer cloths just massive over the stage, and he just went, bless the Lord. Somebody grabbed one, went to a fax machine, faxed it to a hospital. No kidding. Faxed it to a hospital in Texas. There was a child there. It was extremely ill, and they took the fax paper and put it on the kid as he was healed.
Oh, yeah!
So there's no barrier.
Yeah,
yeah.
But the opposite. Well, the picture that I saw, I felt like there were some bones that had little fractures. So I speak to the bones right now in Kevin's left hand, and I restore every bone. I command every bone to be solid right now in Jesus' name. I restore the bones. All fractures healed right now. All pain be gone. All trauma go in Jesus' name. Try it now. So the outside still is hurting up?
Yeah, this is almost.
It is important.
This is almost
like. Okay. I command all pain to come off of this hand right now in Jesus' name. It's a lot better now. Yeah, every bit of pain that's resisting, come off right now in Jesus' name. I pull it all off right now. All pain, all trauma, come off of that. And I declare restoration to that hand right now in Jesus' name. No more pain. You feel a little bit when you go like that? Well, don't go like that.
I bend my finger backwards, it hurts.
Okay, I release healing power right now into Kevin's hand. Through my fingers, I release healing power into Kevin's hand. I command burden in Jesus' name. No more pain, no more discomfort, nerves, muscles, everything be restored now in Jesus' name. So what happened?
I don't trust her.
No, we took you. which hand? What's wrong?
What if he said Jake? Okay. I mean, yeah. Ask Frank. I've done some pretty crazy.
So, okay, Latina. Latina. We release the power of the Holy Spirit on Latina right now. We command healing in her arms, or hand in her arm right now in Jesus' name. Total healing and restoration. We speak to all arthritis and we command it to come out of her body now. In Jesus' name. So are we still going after that finger? You've got more mobility?
It's live still, but nobody's in the
room. Oh, yeah.
Are you trying to get warm?
You won't
let
her. Oh, I'll do it.
I know you would. I didn't laugh about it. I screamed. Who knows, maybe you could scream it too.
Well, you know, I like Steve Wiggles work a lot.
No,
I can relate to him a lot because, you know, he was a plumber until he was in his 40s. I was a Pepsi man until I was in my 40s. He was born in 1859. I was born in 1959. And I
thought
he was
great.